usually reality gets the last word,
yeah.
But with math, you can get the last word, and we can work on the same problems that people worked on thousands of years ago.
In your face, Archimedes!
Imagine what you could have done if you had sanitation and air conditioning. What does your research look like? What do you study?
Well, so I'm an arithmetic geometer. The thing about arithmetic geometry is it sounds like a kind of a funny word, because there's arithmetic, which is like plus and minus and stuff, and then there's the geometry, which is like pictures, and it's not immediately obvious how you blend the two. There's a moment when you're trying to understand, so when you're trying to figure something out. Before you start looking at it, it just looks like a clump of trees. But then there's a moment that hits and you realize, oh my goodness, it's an orchard, and that there's structure there. And there's a moment where your understanding of a subject takes a leap forward. And this is what most people mean, I think, when they talk about understanding something, that they've had that moment, they can see the orchard, they can see the structure and how the trees are laid out in a way that they couldn't, sometimes even just 5 minutes earlier. For me, arithmetic geometry is making those kinds of connections between plus, minus, and times, and geometric objects. Surfaces, it turns out, come in three flavors.
Okay.
There's the ordinary flat kind. The XY plane is like a nice flat thing. The other two ways, broadly speaking, are you can have a surface like a sphere. If you take circles on a sphere and you make them larger, the circumference of those circles grows slower than you would expect given the area of those circles. And that means there's another side to this where the circumference goes faster than you think for the area of the circle you've got. And that's what these are. These are called hyperbolic discs. This is a model of one, and you can see that the circumference is longer for the area because there's only so much fabric in this, but you need ruffles in the fabric in order to accommodate the longer circumference, right?
Okay.
If this were flat, you'd only need this much, but—
So it's like a cone with ruffles in it.
That's
almost.
Right, exactly. It was a man named Bill Thurston. He was incredibly brilliant, and he was giving a talk once about hyperbolic discs and about how you could make a model of them. And his model involved paper and tape. And he was showing you tape it like this and you said, and the problem with paper is that it doesn't stretch and it doesn't deform. You can sort of curve it a little bit, but it doesn't. It's a lousy medium to work with. At that talk, there was a postdoc who knew how to crochet. And she looked at this and thought, this is stupid. Paper and tape, you should crochet it. And so she went to her grandmother and said, you know, how would you crochet them? The grandmother said, it's absurdly simple. You just do it like this. Right? You just add extra stitches every time you go around, and that's what gives you the extra circumference. This tells you very vividly what a negatively curved surface should look like.
It's so fascinating to me that something that could seem like, oh, we don't know how to represent this, someone was like, oh, we already have this answer. And to me, I don't know, it feels like a different kind of eureka moment. There are so many places that we don't always think to look for answers. In this case, textile arts and like the history of women's knowledge. And we don't consider all the different possibilities of knowledge. We're not always going to be looking for all the different possible solutions to a problem, even if it's just crocheting something. It also feels a little bit like an elf hat, so take that, Craig Kaplan. We have hats over here, too.
Absolutely.
Or like lettuce, a little bit like ruffled lettuce.
It is a lot like lettuce, actually, green leaf lettuce, yeah.
A lot of what you're doing is looking for these really interesting mathematical explanations or descriptions for phenomena that we already see in the world, but we don't necessarily have the language to think about those or talk about those.
Absolutely,
like,
yeah.
This looks like structures we've seen, but we didn't necessarily understand until we labeled these or theorized them. How do we explain this? Least favorite depiction of a mathematician in a movie?
Ian Malcolm from Jurassic Park.
Why?
Because just never makes any sense.
Favorite shape?
Oh, sphere.
Do you have a favorite word?
Yes, I do. It is himajin. H-I-M-A-J-I-N. It is a Japanese word that means people with too much time on their hands.
Like pure mathematicians?
No.
Never. Thank you so much for taking the time to hang out and answer all my weird questions. And I will be thinking about crocheted hyperbolic discs for a long time. I wonder if I could knit one of those.